The universal temperature transmitter does the exact same job as the fixed temperature transmitters. It converts the small temperature probe signals to a 4 to 20 milliamp loop signal. The difference is, you don't need to worry about getting the exact unit you need. You just get this one universal unit, either DIN rail or sensor head form factor, and configure it for the probe type and the temperature range. You'll need this special USB programming cable and a copy of the free software to configure the universal units. Plug the cable in here on a DIN rail transmitter and here on a sensor head transmitter, and connect the transmitter to a 4 to 20 milliamp loop. In this video, we're going to bypass the controller and simply put the milliamp meter here so we can see what the current loop is doing. The software looks like this. If you know the COM port number, or you can look it up in a device manager, put it here. You can use the auto detect, but it typically takes several minutes to scan all the possible ports, and I don't have the patience for that. But it does work if you want to do it that way. Select the type of transmitter you're using, XTD for DIN rail mounted, or XTH for head mounted. I'm using the head mounted unit in this demo, so we'll select XTH. This release code is a password that we'll discuss later, but if someone previously set this, you'll need it to get access to the unit. Make sure you have power applied to your 4 to 20 milliamp loop, and that the cable's plugged in, and then hit OK. The connection initializes, and then you get a window like this. In the standard settings, we select the sensor type. This universal transmitter supports a wide range of sensors, including both RTD and thermocouples. We're using a J thermocouple in this demo. You can select the units you want to use in the rest of the menus, and finally select the temperature range your sensor supports. You can find that in the sensor's datasheet, or right on the Automation Direct website. Looks like the temperature range for this probe is 32 to 900 degrees F. If you like all that, you can download the configuration of the transmitter, and you're done. Easy. You can read the settings back from the sensor by hitting this button. I'll reset my numbers so we can see them come back, and sure enough they do. You can print out the configuration using this button, save the configuration to file here, and read the configuration from file here. That's nice because you don't have to retype everything every time you want to configure a transmitter. Just open it and send it to the transmitter. In the expanded settings, you can fine-tune things a bit. Do you want the temperature to use its own internal compensation, or do you want to take care of it yourself? It's rare that you would do it yourself, so you'll usually hit the built-in compensation. If you do it yourself, then specify the fixed reference temperature that you want the sensor to compensate to here. Of course, all this compensation stuff only applies to thermocouples. If we had chosen a two-wire RTD and wanted external compensation, you would see a box here for the cable resistance. You would simply measure that and put it here. We're using a thermocouple, and we'll go with the built-in compensation. If there is a fault, like a short or a sensor break, you can tell the transmitter to send a low, something below 3.6 milliamps, or a high, something above 21 milliamps. That's an awesome feature, and you'll want to make sure you build it into your controller program so you can actually detect when there's an issue with the sensor. You can invert the output, so cold is high current and hot is low current. That's usually just a personal preference, or it's dictated by the system you're working with. You can change the filter time. That's how much time do you want to average the temperature over. It helps smooth out the results and saves you the effort of having to do it in your controller program. You can specify an offset. Suppose you know there's a difference of, let's say, 3 degrees between your target and your probe. You can enter that here so your controller gets the actual temperature of the thing you're trying to measure. Again, so you don't have to do it in your controller program. You can adjust that by up to plus or minus 18 degrees F. You can type any 8 characters you want here to help identify this configuration in the printed reports. I'll type XMeter Demo. And when I print it out, I see that right here to remind me what this configuration was for. The last section, Service Functions, is where you set the password. Remember when we first started this, we had asterisks here? If we had put a 4-digit code here and wrote it to the transmitter, then anytime anyone tries to access this transmitter in the future, they'll have to enter that same code. Please be careful with this. If you set a password and forget it, there's no way to get access to the transmitter's configuration. There isn't even a way to reset the transmitter to factory default. So if you call support for help, all they can do is send you to the store so you can buy another one. So be real careful with this. This output current option is an awesome debug feature. If you enable it and enter a current value, it'll set the output current of the transmitter to that value when you write the configuration to the sensor. So let's say we want 10 milliamps. Write it out, and sure enough, Our loop now has 10 milliamps of current running through it. I love this because I can force any value between 3.8 and 20.5 milliamps on the loop and check it back at the controller to see if the controller responds accordingly. Of course, you can also verify the current by using a current meter like I have here. Very handy. Make sure you click away from the field after entering the value. If you don't, the software won't see anything new and won't do anything. Also, make sure you turn this off when you're done, or the sensor will stay in this mode until you come back and change it. So let's turn this off, check the other settings, everything looks good. So we'll do one last write and we're done. The instructions say you have to remove the cable before the transmitter will work. In my experience, it works just fine with the cable plugged in, but just to be safe, make sure the cable is unplugged before doing any real measurements. A couple final notes on using universal transmitters. To comply with UL 61010-1, the unit must be supplied with a Class 2 power supply. You should always disconnect power before making any connections. Pay attention to the shielding recommendations in the insert and the documentation notes. In particular, if you mount the temperature transmitter remotely from the sensor in a field housing, the shield on the 4 to 20 milliamp loop signal must be at the same potential as the shield on the sensor. If you're using grounded thermocouples, you definitely want to use shielded 4 to 20 milliamp loop cable. If you have a lot of electromechanical noise, then you're strongly encouraged to properly shield all cables. Cables that run outside the building should be shielded to protect from things like lightning strikes. You'll want to connect the cable shield to ground at one end only, usually the end closest to the power supply. The reason for that is if you connect the shield to both ends, you've just created a new current path which could introduce ground loops, which could make things worse than having no shield at all. So again, connect the shield at one end only. If you need any help, please don't hesitate to call Automation Direct's free, award-winning tech support during regular business hours. They'll be happy to help you. And don't forget the forums. There are lots of people there that love to share their years of experience. Just don't post any support questions there. Automation Direct support staff doesn't monitor the forums on a regular basis.